Is the mic on? Yeah. Okay, good. Great. Thank you, Cliff, for the introduction and for the opportunity. I kind of wanted to come and speak to you from so many different angles. And so this is a topic that really I'm very passionate about. So if I start going over time, Cliff, just show me, because there might, you know, there's so many stories I can tell about the work we do and the work that needs to be done. I'm worried that I can also probably overwhelm you. So that said, let me save time and go straight to the topic. The reason I chose the topic, the public health officer topic, is because surgeons in general, we don't see ourselves as public health officers, which is actually a mistake and actually is a problem as well. If you look, OBGYN docs, they portray themselves as public health officers, and they do actually behave as such and do a lot of impactful activities. So if you want to know about the definition of public health, I think, you know, of course, Wikipedia has its own definition, but pretty much it's to prevent, to promote, and to protect healthy environments. Basically, that's what it is. So, and what we do is clearly, you know, falls into that definition. Just to give you an example, there is 5 million people dying of injuries across the globe. And who are the primary caregivers for this kind of population? It's us. Who is the primary, actually, agents for prevention? It's us. So just to give you another number, you have 8 million people dying of cancer. And what do the role surgeons have in this? It's really immense, both from the preventive side as well as from the promoting side. So I just want everybody to feel, you know, whoever is a surgeon here, to feel that we are indeed public health officers, actually, and we can be in the global arena. And however, because we don't have yet that mindset and we have not really been trained and prepared to think that way, the answer to the next question, are we there yet? The answer is no. But I think we are way underway, and there's a lot of things happening, and I hope some of my presentation can really elucidate a little bit of that and maybe give you a little bit more interest about getting involved in global health, which is basically is a public health, but in the global field. So in my outline, I wanted to go over a few things. One is, you know, go over the surgery piece across the globe. The second part, I just wanted to talk to you about what we have been doing in terms of the Ethiopian project over the years. And I know most of you know that we have a lot of relationships that is ongoing in Ethiopia for several years now. And then if we have time, I'll go briefly on my new activity and mission, which is basically the operation giving back through the American College of Surgeons. The Ethiopian project has, over the years, you know, expanded and morphed into so many different disciplines. We started with a little bit of surgery. However, it ended up with all of this. And as you can see, you know, there's really little of surgery, but there is surgery in it as well. However, when you look at the programmatic activities, it really has broadened itself in such a way that we have taken the holistic approach to taking care of, you know, people as such. And you know, you have to think about food and nutrition. And I wish today my other partner in crime, Heidi Bussey, was here. But we have really put in also some activities around food security and nutrition, because it is a very important aspect of health. And you need to really think about all the different dimensions of health. And maybe the few slides I have can really show you. Other than that, something that I've been really very excited over the past couple of years is the undergraduate students field course, which I am going to show you what we do with those students. I just wanted to give you a perspective about a speech that was given by Dr. Mahler back in, I think, 1980, and he was the Director General of the World Health Organization. So 1980, this is what he said. I quote, Yet the vast majority of the world's population has no access whatsoever to skilled surgical care, and little is being done to find a solution. And this is really a statement that, you know, could actually be given even now. And in fact, a few weeks ago, I had a meeting with some colleagues from Africa representing their surgical colleges. So this was the first picture one of the presenters brought up, trying to describe the deficit they have in terms of manpower. And he said, this is really a big crater. It's a big hole, and we can't fill this. And so when I looked further into the literature, actually there is a report that is out in 2013 that, you know, explains how much that deficit is in terms of healthcare workers across the globe. It's about 7.2 million healthcare workers deficit is out there. And of this, half of it, about 4.2, is in about 56 countries. Of this, about 38 are in Africa. So, and the rest are in Southeast Asia. So in those few countries, there is almost 50% of this deficit concentrated. And because of that, for those of you who have not read the Lancet Commission report that was out last April or May, you need to really read that, because it really gives you the landscape and the magnitude of the problem. And about 5 billion people have no basic and safe surgical access. So the definition of basic and surgical access is also really clearly defined there. I have borrowed a couple of slides from Laura Fisher, who, as you may recall, gave grand rounds last year. And the definitions sometimes of safe might be draining an abscess or reducing a fracture or, you know, giving an antibiotic for a tonsil or some basic surgical needs are not met, or, you know, helping with complicated labor and delivery. And so these essential surgeries, which have been really defined and categorized for us, are trying to basically open up the efforts of the global community to kind of join hands and forces to help out to fill up the gaps. Just to give you some perspectives about, you know, the deficits in general. In the U.S., in the recent census, I think there is about 44 surgeons per 100,000 population. In some of these low and middle income countries, it's less than one per 100,000 population. So the number is really dire. You can see on this little graph here where the burden of disease, which is right here, you can see Africa has about 25%, but it has only 3% of the workforce. Whereas if you come into the Americas, you can see there is 10% of burden, but over 35% of the workforce. So these imbalances are so critical and are getting magnified every year. And this basically summarizes the previous graphic. When I went to Ethiopia just for a week of becoming a visiting professor and work with them on their surgical residence exam, this is what I saw on the wards. This is terrible. I mean, there is none of this is something I can help with, or anybody for that matter can help with. And unless we really think this from a major public health intervention point of view, unless we do that, there is no way to save this, college student who has a sarcoma, or this 19-year-old person with a bladder extrophy. So it's really, amazing and really sad. And I really think, in general, in the U.S., there is lack of knowledge about these deficits. And I think partly the college needs to really take initiatives to educate our members and the public in general to make sure, when we live in this world that's a global world where, as soon as somebody sneezes in Senegal, we have a cold here, or when we hear Ebola, it's a crisis which is worldwide. These are also going to be of such a magnitude where this interdependent community of human beings where our economies are tied to each other can really go astray. And so we have a vested interest in being part of the solution. A lot of times people talk about, well, surgery is expensive. It takes a lot of time to train surgeons. There are so many excuses to really define that surgery should not be, you know, surgical deficits should not be addressed in a systematic way. Just thinking that the impact is low. You know, there are so many different excuses that are out there. In fact, if you go and look at from policymakers' point of view and look at how much money is spent in, for example, HIV-related research and funds worldwide compared to how much is spent for trauma, it's amazing. So if you look the numbers, back in 2011 or 12, there was $900 million towards HIV and AIDS versus $20 million versus trauma. However, we know trauma kills more people than HIV, TB, and other communicable diseases combined. So this has to really be one of the things that we have to push forward with, and it's getting more traction. The World Health Organization has recently declared that essential surgery has to be part of the basic healthcare and human rights issue. And so hopefully it will get some traction and move forward. So here are some numbers, and in fact, to just talk about the impact and to talk about expenses, you know, you can see where we use the measure of DALIS, which is disability adjusted life years, to really compare if you want to compare medical issues, communicable diseases to surgical diseases. There's a lot of money and lives to save. And if you look at the expenses in terms of DALIS, for example, having emergency obstetrics care in Bangladesh saves $10 per DALI averted. And if you look at, say, the supply of vitamin A to prevent childhood blindness, prevents $9 per, you know, $9 per DALI averted. On the other side, you can also see actually a lot more impactful measures, such as primarily in the congenital birth-related defects, where the DALIs averted have a lot more cost benefits, which has been shown actually by our surgical colleagues who have been in the global surgery arena doing this research. Most importantly, when people went back to calculate, this is how much money is needed. This is really not a lot of money when you think about, you know, how much money is spent in other things. When you think about how much money we spend in healthcare expenditure in the U.S. So the cost-benefit ratio for the developed world, for all of us, in terms of trying to lend a hand is really not negative. It's 10 to 1, and so we should all kind of embrace this idea. So that said, we talk about deficits elsewhere, but there is deficits in the U.S. as well. Despite 44 surgeons per 100,000, there was a recently commissioned work back in 2006 by the American College of Surgeons and Health Policy Research Institute, where they found a lot of what they call surgical deserts, areas where communities have not even a single surgeon. There were about 30 counties in the U.S. where there was no surgeons. And they have found that about 10 million people are affected by this, so that they have to really travel to find a surgeon. So there is that problem in the U.S. as well. And if we look at the workforce in the U.S., about 27% of the workforce is foreign graduate. So we are attracting from those countries where there is so much deficit for people to come here. But we're not really doing enough to help them retain or support, you know, and give back. And in fact, the calculations are every time we get a doctor come and start working in the U.S., it's a net of $250,000 that the country or the U.S. or England or wherever these physicians go is benefiting from. That said, this desert in the U.S., particularly the inner cities and the rural counties, are also a problem. And in fact, there is a projection that the deficit by 2025 is going to be even greater because of the aging population, because of population number going up. And so what I'm trying to say with this is really that we have a global problem, and it is not only a low-income and developing world problem, but it is also going to affect us. And in this world that is more and more connected, the problem that happens in Singapore is also going to be our problem. And health has been actually the area where the globalization part has not really taken off. And we have to embrace that and start really working towards that goal, because the world is really where the community we live in. So this is some numbers which, you know, I can share the slides anytime, but all what I said earlier is really summarized here. All right. So I think the answer was given away at the beginning. I just wanted to put this page just to really summarize benefits, because unless we think global health as beneficial for everyone, there is, you know, if we start thinking that we are only the givers, then things are not going to last long. And we have to really think about what is the benefit we have in doing this, other than the highest, you know, ethical, the moral satisfaction we get. But there are tangible benefits we'll also be getting out of our global engagement. And innovation is one. Think about 80 to 90% of the world population is living in the rest of the world where resources are scarce. And when resources are scarce, that's where you become innovative. And think about the ultrasound examples from GE, the sonocytes and so on and so forth. They were created out of need because nobody will buy those humongous big machines that we usually carry around here. However, if you look at the benefit, it actually became so beneficial for us. So there is a lot of innovation that's out there, and I think getting involved in global health and global surgery is going to help us actually create things that can not only become a solution for the 80 or 90% of the world population, but probably more so for us as well, where we might be able to contain costs, deliver care better, and become a lot more efficient in so many ways. There are similarities with rural health care in the U.S. There is a lot to learn by going to these third world countries and low-income countries. Mobile technology is actually an amazingly expanding, and in some areas, they do a lot more mobile stuff than we do here. And I'll tell you in a little bit, in a survey we did or in a project we are involved with in very rural areas of Ethiopia, there was 59% of the population had cell phones. It's incredible. And so I remember a conversation about wound-related issues here, and can we really use technology like cell phones to look at the wounds? You know, my thought was, even in that rural Ethiopia, 57% of people have cell phones. Absolutely, you should be able to kind of use that kind of technology over here as well. So technology is really making a difference, and I think the innovation part that is going to come is going to be critical. So why did I put this very difficult question to answer? I'll give you the reason why. So a couple of years ago now, I was trying to buy a phone card to call Ethiopia. So I go to this gas station where they have international phone cards, and I go and say, you know, I want to call Ethiopia Can you give me which one is the best calling card? So this guy picks up, looks through his list of cards and picks up one and gives me this card. He says, this is the best one to use. And I look at that and it says Asia. And I was like, but Ethiopia is not in Asia. So he's like, yes, it is. I was like, no, it is not. And so we got into this conversation about how many continents he knows. And he tells me, well, there's America, Asia, and Australia. So with that, we had a little more lessons about geography, but I'm sure almost all of you know where Ethiopia is, but Ethiopia is really in that eastern horn part of the Africa, in a very geopolitically volatile area where we are in the mix of, surrounded by countries that like Somalia, like the Sudan, where there is really no peace. And Ethiopia used to be also a country where we had war for many, many years, and the last 17, 18 years there has been peace, and therefore there's a lot of prosperity now, and it's actually one of the emerging markets with double-digit GDP growth for the past 10 years. So it's incredible how much activity there is, and actually how much people are really trying to make it and get into a higher living standard. So I just wanted to go quickly into the Ethiopian project by showing you a few pictures here. And we started actually trying to develop a surgical relationship, and we had some visitors. Some of you might have met these three colleagues from Addis Ababa University who came here. We got them through a nice structured program where we took them to meetings. They had simulation trainings. We showed them how the cancer programs work. And then we started actually having some dialogues. But so most of my guests actually ended up going and drinking beer or playing with kids. And what happened was we really did not manage to take that relationship to the next level. I had to step back and look at why this happened and why it did not work. So message number one, I just want to really convey to you guys, the younger ones who may want to play an international field, is the idea, the relationship, what I wanted them to do, and how I wanted to really start the programs done. It was all my idea. I was telling them, this is what you should do. You should do this, this, and this. You need this, this, and this. So this was not a shared goal. It was not a shared idea. I was not at that time really listening to what their needs might be, and I did not really ask what their needs were. So that was basically the problem. So what I'm trying to say here is, when we engage in this kind of international relationship, having really a sit-down conversation about the goals, and making sure those goals are shared, and making sure also those goals are kind of construed around accountability, where each has specific responsibilities and so on and so forth, is the right way to do. And so when I told one of the colleagues, you're going to be the trauma guy, you're going to be the cancer guy, and you are going to be the laparoscopy guy. And so they're like, okay, you say so, but we're not going to do it. And in fact, it did not really work well. But subsequently, I really went back and looked critically at this. And this is now the model we use. It is what we call a twinning partnership. So this was how, when the Eastern Bloc countries, you know, fell apart, and some of them were joining the European Union, to bring them up to speed, they created what they called the twinning partnership models, whereby they will actually work together for the shared goal of them improving and getting their systems in order to be members of the Union. And so these are all kind of based on anchored around volunteerism, but volunteerism from all parties, peer-to-peer relationships, but significant amount of institutional support from both sides. And it has also to have, you know, the local political support. So we really, you know, drilled down into this, and most of the work we subsequently did came from, basically, are based and anchored on developing shared goals with whatever activity we do. And the results actually showed up clearly right away. So, for example, our first partnership was an emergency medicine partnership. So when we talk about emergency medicine, you know, it doesn't mean only the ED, right? It means, you know, the surgeons need to be involved, the labs need to be involved, the radiology guys need to be involved. So what I learned through this process was how actually this is a very critical component of the hospital, where you basically have, if you fix this, you can fix so many other departments in the hospital. And so with that, we had our work cut for us. We started fellowships. We started residency programs. We started nurse practitioner programs. These are all things that never existed. And right now, in Ethiopia, actually, these are the first five emergency medicine graduates for the country. And the third batch graduated last year. And we have now actually programs that are going to start in other universities, in other three universities, where emergency medicine is going to be started. If you look here, this is Sabrina, and this is Josh from pediatrics. These were the first two pediatric fellows, that emergency fellows. The pediatrics emergency department did not have an owner. It did not have any owner of the area where emergency care was provided. But now there is a system in place. If you look over here, these are the nurse practitioners. We call them masters in emergency medicine. We actually graduated 20 a year. And up to date, there is about 80 that have graduated. And they have actually been from all over Ethiopia. So our basically impact has really reached out to the entire country, because now the nurses are the primary providers wherever there are no physicians. And they have organized the hospitals and the clinics. So you see how when you start really with something that there is interest from both parties, the impact has been incredible. Here is what we call the Emergency Medicine Training Center. As of last year, there were about 4,000 people, healthcare professionals, who were trained through that Emergency Training Center. And, you know, name it, first responder, paramedics, ambulance drivers. Actually, because of this work that we have done with Addis Ababa University, the Ministry of Health now sent this year 16 physicians to start emergency medicine residency program. Now we are overwhelmed. I mean, this is too much. But this is how much actually there is now a buy-in from the political system. And the Ministry of Health has ordered 800 ambulances for the country. And now there is, imagine, 800 ambulances. You need at least 6 people to man the ambulance. And multiply how many people we have to train. And Anne O'Rourke was one of those who went the first time actually trying to help them set some of the curriculum. Although there was a lot of frustration. Believe me, all that conversation and insight they provided has helped them actually carve out and figure out what works for them. And so these are impactful things that have happened through this project. I don't want to rush through the whole thing, but the Medical Education Partnership Initiative is another U.S. Grant that actually allocated $130 million for 13 universities, primarily in Africa, where medical education, faculty retention, and research infrastructure development was really the main thing. However, from the faculty retention perspective, and And there was really such a huge gap on gender promotion. So some of our colleagues from University of Wisconsin, including Cindy Hack, which you see here, have taken that really to the next level. We have had 9 fellows actually come here, spend a couple of weeks with some of our leaders, and learn from here is things that they could then contextualize and work it in Ethiopia. So this has really been impactful. In fact, I just got an information yesterday that although we have been 5 years out, but it has been extended. So when we do all this, we talked about twinning partnerships, which are important. The second message I have is you have to start working at this thinking also the how is this going to be sustainable? How are we going to keep this? And what are the kind of skills we need to provide? And so things like quality improvement program trainings were basically the anchor to all this. Almost all faculty that were involved in our programs have been trained to think about quality, to define quality, and create in their environment things that can help them basically bring the quality of whatever they do to the next level. Because we're not going to expect them just to go and replicate what we do in our emergency department, but they can really think about it and work through quality improvement. So we have actually about a 16-hour thing. We incorporated research. Because if you go and look, some of the major reasons why people are dissatisfied is because they don't have any academic advancement possibilities. They don't have any possibilities of doing research. So with research, actually the amount of people engaged now and the amount of papers that are written is actually creeping up every year. And so we have had, colleagues again, you can see from here, this is Nizar, this is Liz Jacobs, and this is Karen Solette, who have been multiple times to Ethiopia to really help them develop not only the research infrastructure building, but also the mentorship program. And now the mentorship program is actually completely taken by the locals. We have trained enough people to train their own folks, and we are not doing that anymore. And the same with the research methodology. And I think sustainability of the things we do has to be planned from the get-go. And that's really important. And creating relationships actually within the continent was very critical. So we actually took some time and engaged some colleagues from South Africa because it's much easier to have their perspective than the U.S. perspective. Sustainability means also thinking about, governance and advocacy, creating societies. And this was the first meeting we had actually creating the Society for Emergency Medicine Professionals. We called it professionals because it included physicians, nurses, paramedics, and all those. So that part really is where most of the work at the level of the hospital is, but we have expanded further in giving opportunities to our medical students. The Shapiro students have been to Ethiopia almost every year. These are some of the examples, and this is Laura Hanks, who actually spent 6 weeks in Ethiopia, and she actually was productive. She had a paper that was published in the Journal of the East and Central Surgical Association of Africa, so which actually pointed out that appendicitis was an issue. In acute abdominal emergencies in that part of the continent, volvulus is usually the biggest problem for many, many years. But in her study that she did with colleagues from Addis, it was clear that there was a change, and appendicitis was becoming the problem. And we have other students engaged. Just for the sake of time, I'll just move on to the next thing we have really been doing. And you remember I mentioned about nutrition and environment and systems in general. So we should really think globally in a way not only about the surgery or the vaccinations, but you know, there's so many different systems. So we have created an environment where our students are engaged in discussing food systems, discussing environmental systems, healthcare systems, locally in Ethiopia, and they have really a much broader understanding. And I'll show you in a minute, the undergraduate students really love it. Almost all of them, after a trip for 3 weeks in Africa, when they come, they know what they are going to do. And it is really amazing, actually, to take those young kids who are totally undifferentiated, and you take them there, and they come back with, you know, a plan for the next chapter when they finish the college. So we have had a lot of engagements, but what I wanted to tell you is, you know, just with this slide, and I'm not an economist or an ag major, but what is really important is how all things impact in such a way that if you don't have health, if you don't have food, if you are poor, all those things are like in a circle. And so the social scientists have already defined that, and so I think the public health models are now trying to really pick that idea and create atmospheres where our youth can really understand all these dimensions of health and not just focus only on disease. But there is really a lot of dimensions. This is how we got into the sweet potato thing. So this is, by the way, sweet potato on banana leaves that served for us for lunch. The sweet potato project is something that's focused in few communities in the southern part of Ethiopia. And you know, this takes by itself another talk, but what is really important is it really provided for some of our students an area where they could go and study and learn from different aspects in those areas, not only nutrition, but also the environment, but also how healthcare works, and how wealth is defined, and so on and so forth. We have gotten a grant, and that's how we have been functioning, and the amount of engagement we had with the youth locally has been incredible. And if we don't involve the youth, making sure the youth is engaged in these activities to become the next leaders, there is really no community or social development that's going to happen. And so we really think this youth development has really worked both ways. And I'll show you some testimonies from some of our students that was sent to us. So over the past few years, we have had 3 credit hour field courses where we have taken anywhere between 9 to 10 students, not because there wasn't many applicants, but we really wanted to be engaged, be in a smaller group rather than a huge group. So this year, there was like 30 applicants. So we are going to take about 12 of these students. So what we do is we kind of prepare this list here. Guest speakers, site visits, observation, reflection, storytelling, dialogues. We prepare them actually for 3 months or so before we go. In Ethiopia, for example, you know, the first thing we do is we learn about how the agricultural system works. We go to the Agricultural Development Agency. We talk with the leaders. We spend the morning. We have experts in the city of Addis. History, architecture, geography, and we learn about that. We spend some time with local entrepreneurs. How is business work? And here is a young lady, I don't know if you see back here, but she has been actually on the Forbes list, and she's in Ethiopia. And she's one of the young entrepreneurs that has been really revolutionizing cottage industry. We go to the universities where we learn about the environment. There are environmental scientists who really play a major role in international meetings. We spend some time with experts that are working in the international arena. And of course, we have fun and we go around and shop. The students are engaged in community development. So this is For example, a site where we go, and this year we're going to spend a week actually at this site. It's a community development area where at least this module for one of the students was really to discuss about health with the local youth. And as you can see, the physical, the social, the spiritual, emotional health is discussed in a bilateral, you know, conversational manner. We have a lot of learnings we have done from some community leaders in very cozy, nice environments, very safe environments. Students have had several independent projects over the years. One student developed what we call the Sidama Traditional Medicine Plant Catalog. It's a 40-page document he created, taking pictures of those traditional medicine plants, talking with the locals who tell him what those traditional medicines are used for, finding the pharmacological name for the chemicals in there, writing them in the local language, and now that has become actually a book for reference for the locals. We have had a showing of some coffee, black gold. One of the students really wanted to portray that and how the coffee market works, how it works in a major disfavor for the local farmers in the developing world. She really created a nice documentary. So there is a lot of activities the students do. And here are some of the quotes from the students. And I'll just let you read them for yourselves. It's really, really enriching and makes me so happy at the end of these trips. Not only having spent some quality time with them, but seeing how much impactful it has been. And, so the same here. The world feels both a lot smaller and a lot larger after traveling to Ethiopia. And it is really exciting, actually, to see how much the students change by the time they come back. This is a faculty quote I got last week, actually, from one of our faculty members who was visiting in Ethiopia. And you know, she said, "Hey, thank you so much for the opportunity to go to Ethiopia. It was an amazing experience. Can't wait to share more. I met so many wonderful people, and it's really a remarkable place. I can see why everybody wants to return over and over again." And in fact, when we asked our volunteers the same question, you know, overwhelmingly, 95% of the time they want to go back. And when we asked if you want to tell your colleagues to participate, again, you know, 96% of the time they said they would. So these are really things that have gotten to a point where, you know, we are really growing and expanding and having a lot more impactful thing for our, you know, medical students, for undergraduate students, for our faculty members as well. And there is a lot of actually academic growth and productivity our own faculty members have gotten from there. So where are we going to go next? I mean, there is a lot more to do. I really hope Dr. Kent was here. And hopefully he will listen maybe to this part of the tape where we need to really have our organized, formalized, you know, global surgery activity under the department's umbrella. I think, as you know, Dr. Benz has a wonderful program with the Nicaragua Connection for Plastic Surgery Division. However, all these individual efforts we all do should really be kind of owned by the department, I think. And when I say be owned, it also means be supported, resourced. So not that we want to give, but I think there is enough talent, there is enough relationship that we have built, and we can, you know, definitely create, hopefully, opportunities for our global citizens. And, you know, the resident members, 92% at the ASES, want global surgery to be something they want to do. And so there is really moving going forward. This is this is something that we have to respond actually to the upcoming global generation that we are working with and looking forward to. So that said, as I mentioned earlier as well, I think with 90% of the world population living elsewhere, you know, we have really a lot of medical innovation we can do, and we have to be part of it, and we have to really organize ourselves. I think for the sake of time, Cliff, I think I better stop here because I'm sure there are some questions that can be asked, and if there are questions about the ACS, I can answer. I just wanted to go to this slide to say I really want to thank so many people. I mean, that has been part of this project. If I started putting lists, I was worried that I'll forget. And particularly this young lady has been the primary anchor for all the work we have done, and I can't thank her enough. Here you see people from Global Health, and even as we speak today, there is 5 people coming from Ethiopia with the Global Health, and a few weeks ago, there were like 6 of them through the OBGYN department. So there is really an amazing amount of work that is being done, and of course, I couldn't have done all this without the amazing support I had from home, with my wife being behind all what I do and allowing me to go and have all this fun. So I really want to thank her. With that, I'll stop here, and if you guys have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.